Good morning, everybody. God bless you. God bless you. Let's play a little morning. Welcome to High Ground Christian Church. Let me play a little bit of music here real quick from one of my favorite
songs. Song in our house. I want those that have your Bibles to hold.
Can't lie, I love it, guys. Say, I love all his music.
Brother
John P.
Hey. Don't let you love God's word. Scream one more time in this show.
I want no more. Bread of heaven. Feed me to the Lord. Oh, no more.
Somebody grab your Bible and just hold it in the air like this.
Take another hand outside
the place. I'm saying, I love the world. Put it down and clap your hands with me. Come on.
Excited about that, John P. Key. That's some good stuff right there. I may play a little bit more at the end, but real quick, God bless y'all. Thank y'all for tuning in today to High Ground Christian Church. Let me first of all give y'all a vision statement, which is comes from Colossians 3, 1 and 2. It says, if then you have been raised with Christ, then seek the things that are above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things that are above and not on the things on this earth. I think that's very important. I keep saying that, and I will keep saying that. We got to put our minds on Christ. We got to put our minds on God and the things above. Let's pray real quick. Lord, thank you for this day, God. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for what you've done and what you're going to do, God. Let this word that's been preached and taught, God, let it be to your edification and the glory of your kingdom, God. We thank you for all that you've done for our people, God. I think that thank you for just blessing us to wake up this morning, God, giving us another chance to do your will, God, and work for you, God, and live for you, God, and get it better and do right, do better than we did yesterday, God. We thank you and we love you, God. I'm asking for healing for a lot of people who are sick in their bodies, God. I'm asking for deliverance for a lot of people who are sick in their minds, God. I'm asking for strength and power right now in your mighty name of Jesus, God. I ask that you just continue to cover us, lead us, and guide us in your way. We love you. We praise you. We glorify you. And we know things are going to get better, God, because of you, God. But we have to go through these trials and tribulations. But you got us, God. Keep us right now. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Yeah. God, thank you. I appreciate him. I really do. I love the Lord. Listen, yesterday, man, I want to tell you that it was our first annual Thanksgiving food drive. We had a drive through, and some people really came through and blessed us. And I'm excited about it because it's nothing like blessing and helping people. A lot of people always say, you know, you shouldn't name folk or you're going to forget or whatever. But I'm a big advocate about when people do something for you, you ought to tell them thank you. You ought to appreciate people, you know, not just because, oh, it's the church and you should be doing it. But people don't have to be nice. And there were some people that blessed us by giving and sowing into the ministry to help bless some people. A friend of ours, Tamika Wilson, and helped us out. Miss Betty Andrews, she was a blessing to us. Thank you, Miss Andrews. I appreciate it. Miss Margot Scott, thank you so much for blessing us. Michelle Ely and Michelle Knight and from Left Center, we love you and appreciate. Even my cousin, Pastor Vincent Broomfield, gave us a blessing. We thank him. Miss Diane McNeil sent us a check. Thank you. God bless you. My mother-in-law then bless us and did some wonderful things. My mother then gave. Even one of my daughters, she's in the Navy, and I know she needed her money, but she blessed us. Jamie, thank you. I appreciate it. Listen, there are some other people that have given, and I appreciate it for what you've done. And even if you had a heart to give, I thank you, and I appreciate what you did. Some people even came out and helped us. One of my wife's good friends, Nikki, she runs a food bank, and she does a lot, but she donated all the boxes to us, and I appreciate what she did. She, because she's a professional in this, she kind of gave us some insight, even though we still had to run it alone. She gave us some insight on what we could do and where we could go, and we thank God for it, because, I mean, when you're a nonprofit, if you have a 501c3, it helps a lot to do some other things. Even though we still have to come out of money, out of our pockets, God was blessed. I have to thank some of my family members too. My in-laws, Krista, my wife's sister, her husband, Jeff, two boys, Jalen and Jamal, they came and helped. Another good friend of mine, Chris, who plays keyboards in a band that I used to play, that I play in. I thank God for him. He came out and helped out. I thought that was really great. Even some of my neighbors right around me, Tara, Mia, and Perry, I thank y'all for helping out. Even my daughter Michaela came up and helped a little bit yesterday. I had a good friend named David Gibbs. He heads up this group called the South Fork and Housing Affordability, where they're trying to make housing more affordable for people. And I really appreciate him. He came out and stepped up in a big way, leading and directing folks. So I appreciate him. And most of all, I really have to tell y'all, this probably wouldn't have went off like it should have if it wasn't for Lady Ziegler. I really appreciate her. She thought I was about to name somebody else, but she really helped get this thing together. Me and her rode to every store and picked up every single item that y'all saw. So I thank God for her. Tabitha, thank you. I appreciate it. I love you, and I really appreciate the work you did as the administrator of the church. And this is not an easy task. And when people think, you know, giving, it does come straight from the heart. But it's work involved, and you have to go out and do the work. You got to get the work done. I tell you, some people think it's you're in a position, they think you rich or you got money when you give like this. No, it's giving back. And when you tithe into your church and you pay into the church, the money that goes to the church is not to be sat there to build up riches for the church. Unless you're doing something, building a building, getting some other things, but it's to help in the neighborhood. It's to bless people. It's to bless people. That's what it's for. That's what they were doing when they were giving to King Hezekiah. He was blessing the people, going back out and blessing the people. They were storing it up, bring all the stores into the storehouse, that it may be me in my house. You know, that's to bless other people. So it has nothing to do with us. We ain't got to be the biggest. I think Tyler Perry did one today from 8 to 12. And everybody has different levels. He got different kind of money, and that's great. But we just take what we have and bless what we can. And I even have a scripture for it. I want y'all to know this. Luke 14, 12 and 14, it says, "And he also went on to say to the one who had invited him, 'When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbors. Otherwise, they may also invite you in return, and that will be your repayment. But when you give a reception, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed, since they do not have the means to repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous.'" And so that's why we do it. It's not so much that we're getting anything back. We saw people drive up that had BMWs. We had some had Infiniti Q45s. It didn't matter to us. People are being blessed. One lady, my wife says, she was driving off and she was crying. And you know what? That's how people are hurting nowadays. And I saw it yesterday. A lot of people called me and talked to me. People were doing it all over. And that's what we're here to do, is to bless people. And it should start with the church. If we have it, this just should start with us. We understand coronavirus is big, but it was a drive-through. Didn't nobody have to get out? We didn't have to get close to the people. I also want to thank, I had a voter registration come out yesterday, and we registered people to vote. and then on top of that, I'm going to share something with you guys so you can see it. They are hiring people right now to help with the voter registration. So I took a picture of it, and I said, you know, I'm going to tell anybody. Sure, I'm going to give my daughter Michaela. She's going to be calling on the phone herself. $20 to $22 an hour plus bonuses and overtime. Here's the phone number. I don't care where you at. If you're out of state, call it anyway and see. It could be for everybody. 470-977-2962. Or you can go to the website, apply.fieldworks.com. So I thank God this was another opportunity, not just for food, but for people to get a job, for people to get signed up for registration to vote. And of course, I do think that's important. So God bless y'all. I'm glad that all that happened, and we look to do bigger things. As a matter of fact, I'm not gonna lie to you. I'm not a big advocate of just giving out a bunch of toys. I look to go towards the needs of people, and so we are looking. Next thing is to try to bless people with rent or whatever. I don't care if it's $200 to 10 different people. We want to bless somebody to put towards their bills or put towards the rent. I mean, we don't have a whole lot of money. We're not balling like that, but whatever. We tithe back into the church. We tithe and back out. It ain't to sit on this money and to do nothing with it, but bless the people in your neighborhood or bless the people around you. So listen, I'm encouraging you, because it's crazy that me and the church, me and my wife got a chance to do this, and my family. It doesn't matter how big you are. It's where you're at. Do the work where you're at. You can't go across the seas, and you can't go. Do it where you're at. people in your neighborhood need to be blessed. I guarantee you there's some people that need your help. So thank y'all for that. I really do appreciate it. God bless you. And for all the people that gave encouraging words, we thank you for what you said. So let me get to the word today. I'm coming from John chapter 6. John chapter 6. And we're going to start at verse 24. This is what the word of God says. It says, when the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they also got into boats and came to Capernaum seeking Jesus. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come over here? Jesus answered them and said, most assuredly, I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him. In verse 28, it says, then they said to him, what shall we do that we may work the works of God? Jesus answered and said to them, this is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he sent. Verse 30 said, therefore they said to him, what sign will you perform then, that we may see it and believe you? What work will you do? That's funny. Today, we couldn't even fathom asking Jesus to do no signs and stuff like that. We just believe him. We know he's able. But back in that day, they said, what you gonna do? Show it to us. Show us what you can do. But in verse 31, it says, our fathers ate the manna in the desert, as it is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat. Then Jesus said to them, most assuredly, I say to you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Then they said to him, Lord, give us this bread always. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. Today, I want to preach about the bread from heaven. That's why I'm playing the song, Bread of Heaven, from John P. Key. And in his song, they're talking about the word of God. He does it before he preaches, Bread of Heaven, talking about the word of God. But I want to give you some background to this, since you see what Jesus was saying to them. I'm the bread of heaven. I'm the bread of life. And they were looking for him and talking about how, well, tell us what you're going to do. Because back in our days, our fathers, Moses, they gave us manna from heaven. And Jesus had to correct them. It wasn't Moses. So I'm going to give y'all some background to this. If you go to Exodus with me, chapter 16, Exodus 16 and verse 4, this is what happened. It says, then said the Lord unto Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a certain rate every day, that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or no. Let me tell you what God was saying to them. This is what's fun. I want to give you the background now. They were out in the wilderness, and they are starting to complain because they're hungry. And they like, Moses, this is some foolishness. Now, keep in mind, God didn't already deliver them and took them through the Red Sea, but now they're hungry and they're complaining. And God said to them, since you've been complaining about being hungry and how there's no food and how in this day and time we dealing with a virus and we dealing with the government and crazy stuff dealing with politicians, and we don't have no money and the jobs, and we got to give our food. He said, listen, this is what God said. I'm going to give you bread from heaven, and I'm going to feed you and provide for you so that there will be nothing in the way to keep you from serving me. Now, I will see if you will follow my word or not, if you will be faithful when I bring you out of your problems and feed you. Are y'all listening to me? Because it's the same thing. Children of Israel act in the same way. He said, I'm going to take care of you like I've been doing while you've been worrying and complaining. And we're going to see if me feeding you will make you have a different mindset and see you'll follow me. Now, in this same chapter, in Exodus chapter 16, there are a couple of more verses, 13 and 14, it said this, and it came to pass that at evening, quails came up. Let me explain, because before this, God had explained to them, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to give y'all meat in the evening, and I'm going to give you manna in the morning. I'm going to give you something to eat at all times. So this is where this scripture comes from. 13, it says, and it came to pass that at evening, the quails came up and covered the whole camp. That's like food just sitting there for you. All you got to do is kill it and eat it. And in the morning, the dew lay around about the host. And when the dew that lay was gone, this is in the morning, behold, upon the face of the wilderness, there lay a small round thing, as small as the hoar frost on the ground. I like that because this is where they got that song from. Like the dew in the morning, gently rest upon my heart. All right, so that's where they got the song. But let me tell you what the dew did. We don't see it that often. You know, you go outside and you see the grass be wet. Ain't nothing but a little dew. But manna. I want to tell y'all what manna is. Because people don't know, they're thinking this is just a Bible thing. Manna is a real substance. It's a substance that exuded from this tree called the tamarisk tree. Mm. The Bible describes it like a coriander seed. It's white and it tastes like wafers or honey. Can y'all imagine? The children of Israel, they got to get quail every night. And in the morning, they got to get this manna that from the dew that laid on the ground after the dew dried up, it left something there, left manna there. And all they had to do was gather it up. Gather all this up and wait a few days, and then they could eat it. And get this, and it tasted like wafers or honey. Wafers with honey. The funny thing is, that's like eating pancakes or cake or bread every day. But keep in mind, manna is half the taste of sugar. So it's sweet, but it ain't as sweet as sugar. So you can eat it every day, and you ain't gonna get no sweet tooth or diabetes. It ain't too sweet, it ain't too sour. It is actually, people still use it today. I'm teaching y'all something. The tamarisk tree, so I looked it up to see what it is. It had about 50 to 60 different species of flowering plants. It's native to drier areas like Eurasia and Africa, but there are people still in Italy and all that. They get the manna together and they cook it. They still cook manna today. People still have it, but God was just giving it to them like he does it for us sometimes when he blesses us after we've been complaining because we've been hungry. And he said, listen, I'm going to provide it for you every day, this bread from heaven. Y'all keep in mind what I'm saying. Y'all stay with me here. I'm going to keep giving you this bread from heaven so I can see if y'all gonna change your mind. But when I think about food though, you know, when you're hungry, you get really agitated and you get frustrated and you get angry. I kind of see what was going on with the children of Israel. We don't see it like that. We be like, oh, I can't believe it. It's complaining, doing all that. But you know what? When you're agitated and you're frustrated and you're angry and you can't eat when you want to, you usually don't have patience with other people. Some of y'all get hangry all the time. That's hungry and angry at the time. A lot of y'all are like that because you're hungry. You need something to eat. I get it. Food. We love to talk about food. After we did the thing yesterday, we went and ate a little bit. But food is, it's a soothing point for most of us. Mm. It can help us feel better. It makes us feel good, depending on what you're eating, some ice cream or something. It tastes good. It puts a smile on your face after you done ate it. It can help you to stop headaches. And it helps to stop your stomach from growling. Food, y'all know it. Y'all go to different places. You, depending on what you eat, want to eat, you're going to go and get you some food to make you feel better. But my question to you is, how long will it sustain you before you get hungry again? Especially in these times where we're just sitting at home and with not a lot to do, and we got all this time on our hands. Some of us are reverting back to just eating food. And don't get me wrong, it's some other ones out here. Many of us, we're eating better. We have better habits for our health. We're choosing what kind of foods we want to eat and making sure that it doesn't have this stuff in it. And we're trying to do better. We're losing weight. Well, some of us. We're looking leaner and we're looking stronger in our physical bodies. But I had a question. I was thinking about it. Are we doing all this so we can do the work of God to please him? Or are we doing this just so we can look better and live longer? Some people don't want to die. They just want to live longer and they want to be better. Now, it could be that you're doing it for all of it. You're living for God. You want to work for God. You want to look better. You want to live longer, be better. As long as it's for God. As long as it's all about God. But I have something different now that we talked about all that. I want to talk about the spiritual bread. I want to talk about something totally different, a different subject. See, when you have this spiritual bread, you can't never go hungry. You can never fall into gluttony either. You can eat as much as you want, and it won't make you too fat. You can never be too obese by indulging in the bread of heaven. Now, we were talking about the manna, and we were talking about the quail. But I'm talking about a different bread now. Some would ask, what is the bread from heaven? I'm glad you asked. So let me explain it. See, in the scripture back in John 6, 24 through 35, when I read it, Jesus said this. He said, I am the bread of life, and he who comes to me will never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. Well, I was thinking about it. I love it because I love it. Some people are like, well, you know, Jesus was with them when he said this back in the day. Yeah, you're right. The situation was Jesus was actually with them at that time, so they could physically see him and they can physically touch him. They had the bread of life with them. They actually had a chance to feed off his every word and listen to him, what he said and what he was speaking at the time. The bread was right there with them. Well, in today's time, we know Jesus is not here physically. We can't see him or touch him physically. But we are able to feed off his every word he spoke. It comes out of here. It comes out of here. So this is when we refer to John chapter 1:1. This is where I'm getting to the bread of life and the bread of heaven. John chapter 1, verse 1 says this, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Well, see, we as believers, if we know what the true Word is, we know that Jesus is that Word. And if we know that Jesus is that Word, then we need to know that the bread of heaven is Jesus Christ. His Word should feed us every day. His Word should encourage us. His Word should make us feel better. His Word should be a good taste in our mouth. His Word should put smiles on our faces. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. His Word should stop headaches and take away stress when we're worried and everything is going, we're going through so much. Oh, we need to feed back on the bread of heaven, which is Jesus. He is the true Word of God. His Word should allow us to share with others and love others just like he loved us. I'm talking about the bread. I'm talking about Jesus. Yeah. What bread are you eating is what I want to ask. What are you indulging on in your everyday life? Have you been living in a wilderness land? And now you're feeling a little hungry? I understand it. I get it. How do you get the bread of life, then you ask? Kind of like the people in Israel. How do I get that bread of life? How do I get back to that way of living where me and Jesus have that connection and I can get the bread of life, I can get the word from him? Well, let me share the instructions of the bread of life with you. It's real simple and we already know it. We have the instructions right here in this word. And I want you to go to Romans chapter 10. In verse 9, these are the same instructions I give at the end of every sermon. It says this in Romans chapter 10 and verse 9. It says that if thou shalt confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, we're talking about the bread, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes on him, the bread, yeah, will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon his name. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then? I'm giving y'all the instructions here. Verse 14 says, how then shall they call upon him in whom they have not believed? That's kind of what the children of Israel are saying. Show us a sign. Tell us what we need to do to have this bread. He said, and how shall they believe in him, the bread, of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things. I just read from you Romans chapter 10, verses 9 through 15. I want to tell you the first step to it. You first have to confess. Yeah. What are you confessing? You got to confess who the true word of God is and what this bread is. It's Jesus. Second thing, you got to believe it. You got to believe. This is what the Bible says. It says you got to confess. You got to believe. And you can't be ashamed. Listen, he said, listen, anybody that believes on me, I won't be ashamed of them. I'm going to uphold them at all times. But you can't be ashamed of him either. You got to love him. Number four, God is not partial when it comes, when you call upon his name. It says to the Jew or the Greek, this is for everybody. I ain't never trying to make this thing no racial thing. This is for everybody. If you call on the name of God, if you call on the name of Jesus and you believe in the bread of heaven, oh, he's going to accept you as you are. Now, all of us got some things we got to deal with. Yeah, when we see him, we got to take responsibility for some things we've done. Number six, though, but you need to hear a word from a preacher. You got to hear a word from the preacher. If you ain't been called and you don't know it, you can't make up stuff for your own self now. Now, the other thing is you can't be listening to your homeboys from down the street who think they can interpret everything and talk about everything. It says the preacher has to be sent from God. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's all right. You think you walk around talking to some people that know everything, but if they ain't been sent from God and they just people that can read and know English real well and can break stuff down somewhat, but not hearing from the Holy Spirit, you need to listen from a preacher that's been sent from God. Now, and the last thing it says, and the feet of the preacher will be beautiful and bring good things. Listen, if God is going to bring good things to the preacher, then the preacher is going to bring good things to the people. It's going to flow from the top down. I want you to know these are the instructions on how you're going to get the bread of life. You gotta be saved, basically. When you come down to it, you gotta confess, you gotta believe, you can't be ashamed, you gotta call upon his name, and it don't matter who you are, he'll save you. You gotta hear from a preacher, you gotta be saved. What I wanna know is, have you snacked on any bread lately? Have you read any scriptures for yourself? Have you heard from a preacher while you've been in quarantine, while you've been sitting at home? Have you been listening? Have you opened your Bible and read a scripture and listened to the preacher lately to get some spiritual bread to help you get along your way? Well, I'm telling you, that's what you need today. Jesus is that bread from heaven. And the way to eat is through his word. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. I get excited about it. Bread of heaven, nourish me. Bread of heaven. Yeah, with the right nutrients. Listen, you can eat a lot of stuff and think you're eating better, but I guarantee you, if you feed on the word of God, your body, everything around it, your spiritual walk, the smile on your face, your mind, it'll take away this instability that people are worried about, mental things. Brother Heffron, keep me from a wilderness of sin. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Y'all better hear the word of God. It can help you provide a sweetness like the dew in the morning, like the dew in the morning. Let it rest upon my heart. Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's what I wanted to do. Yeah. I want to let you know, Jesus, he is the bread of life. Feed on him and live through him, and you will never worry about hunger again. I know we've been going out there feeding people. We're feeding them where their need is. But the true need is them getting a word from God. A word from God can change your whole atmosphere, change your whole life. And the Bible always talks about the poor will be with us always. So we need to help feed them. But in our feeding, we need to share the word of God with them. So today, I'm talking about the bread from heaven, not just any kind of bread that we want to eat at all times, not just the manna that in the quail, but the true bread, which is Jesus Christ, the word. Where in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. That was Jesus. And Jesus said it, for the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. And that's the word, that's Jesus. I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. I want people to be saved. I want people to love God. Even the people that are already saved, I want you to rely on God's word. I want you to hear Jesus. I want you to live better. I want you to be better. Live with him every day. Get a chance, take 5 minutes and read God's word every day until you get into a habit to want to love him and hear from him all the time. Make sure you're not taking advantage of this opportunity, not being able to hear a preacher. Tune in and hear a word of God. Hear some from God so that everybody will love him. They'll be touched. They'll be saved. And we can all indulge in his work. I thank you again for tuning in. And I thank you for hearing the word of God from me. I hope it touched you. Jesus is the true bread from heaven, and his word is a light to our feet. So here we go. If you want to go to our website, higherground.cc.net, if you'd like to be a blessing and maybe you missed out on being a blessing for our food drive, still be a blessing. We're trying to build our account back up to be a blessing to some other people in other ways, whether it's food, whether it's helping with bills. There are some people out there hurting, and we know it. And I saw it yesterday. I already knew it, but I've seen it, and it's a blessing. And even while we were doing some shopping, we saw other people doing the same thing, trying to be a blessing on whatever scale it is, no matter how big and no matter how small. I was telling people, listen, this is not a whole lot when they were coming through, but this is just a small start to get you started with your Thanksgiving. And they told me it didn't matter how small it is, they just really appreciated it. And so we thank God for that. And we were able to give out some gift cards as well. So when we ran out of turkeys, some of the money that was donated to us, we got gift cards and we handed it out. And each one of them could go buy their own turkey. So we thank God for that. So if you want to be a blessing to Higher Ground and to God's ministry, our Cash App is @HigherGroundCC. Our PayPal is Higher Ground Church. Givelify is Higher Ground Christian Church. And you can also find any of these sermons back on our YouTube page at Higher Ground Christian Church. I appreciate y'all. God bless y'all. Y'all enjoy your Sunday. And I'll see you back here on Tuesday. But if I don't see you again, I may come on here Thursday morning for Thanksgiving. I want you to be blessed, and y'all have a great Thanksgiving. Let God bless you and your family, whether you're traveling or not. Be safe, whatever you do. Use good common sense. So many people are still doubting this thing, but I would tell you, just be safe. Me and my family are going to be here together, and we're going to worship together and thank God together. All right, we out of here. Let me pray with you real quick, Lord. Thank you again for this word, God. Thank you for your anointing, God. Thank you for what you have taught us today, God. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your son, Jesus, coming down, dying for us, and living for us, God. We love you, and we thank you for that bread from heaven, God. We appreciate all you've done. Keep us, surround us, let our minds be focused on you, God. We give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. A little bit more, John Pekee, and we out of here. I hope y'all enjoy that song. I like this part, you know what I mean? Hey, I love the world.
If you really need to hear from it, sing this.